It should not be about countries taking positions, aligning themselves with certain groups. It should be about how do we talk about sustainable development for this planet. And for us to achieve that, we need to go beyond ideology. We cannot be treating this like just any other developmental issue. It has to be at the core, how do we find the conditions which allows our planet, I'm not even talking individual states, how does our planet sustain itself? And the development debate, as things stand now, is not sufficient. We are not going in the right direction. In fact, I will go as far as to say sustainable development. We, in 1992, in the first Rio conference, we did achieve something that we achieved a higher consciousness about the need for sustainability, about the need for sustainable development. But sustainable development in action is a myth today. We have not made significant progress in being able to actually achieve sustainable development. If you'll allow me to use small island states, small island developing states as an example, my own country, but also the two next to me. If you look at all of the statistics that relate to small island developing states, there's a lot of concern. Now, a lot of people may not realize that most small island developing states are actually called also middle-income countries. As middle-income countries, therefore, in terms of the development assistance that we can leverage, we are exactly in the same boat as China. Meaning that a small country such as Seychelles, when talking to the World Bank, when talking to the IMF, when talking to the UN, we are, in a sense, talking in the same way that China would be, because we are considered middle income. Now, if you look at the statistics of small island developing states, the debt to GDP per capita ratio is extremely worrying. Most small island developing states have debt to GDP ratios of over 100%. Now, what that means is that we are having to borrow just to survive. And we are not able to finance this in the long term. And a lot of people argue, well, small island states, economies of scale, you are smaller, therefore a lot of things will cost you less. Well, to a degree true, but when you are building an airport, you cannot make the runway any shorter. There are certain costs which simply you have to pay, and what the international development infrastructure offers today does not allow us to develop properly. My dear friend from Dominica mentioned the problems of climate change adaptation funds. We must look at development side by side with climate change, because climate change is the biggest threat to development, not only in small island developing states where it's an existential threat, but to the world. In terms of climate change adaptation, there has been a lack of transparency, adaptation funds, sorry. There's been a lack of transparency. Countries have pledged billions of dollars towards adaptation funds, but this money is not new money. In most cases, this is money that developed states have already allocated, and they are simply saying, well, this is priority for climate change. But the reality is it's not going to where it's needed. Again, small island developing states such as the three of us here, we are middle-income countries. That means when we knock on the door of the World Bank and saying there is money being given to the World Bank for climate change adaptation, they will tell us, you are a middle-income country, you are not a priority. So the funds that are being allocated for climate change are not available to small island developing states. Now, this is a huge challenge for the concept of development that we want to talk about. So in terms of the institutional structure, there's a lot of work for us to be a lot of work for us to do. And we have to remove this ideology concepts. We have to start talking about practically how do we invest in technologies in all of the countries of the world that will allow us to move forward. For Seychelles, we talk a lot about the blue economy. We talk about the blue economy as well as the green economy because we are a country that is surrounded by water. We have only 400 square kilometers of land. We have 1.3 million square kilometers of ocean. And we are guardians of this ocean space. And people underestimate the importance of oceans for the world. How much fish, how much tuna is consumed around the world? And as the oceans rise, the temperatures rise in the oceans, how will we be able to sustain tuna fisheries if we do not address climate change? The blue economy, climate change development, We must deal with these issues as part of the negotiations on climate change, but also in terms of negotiations on development. I would like to say that we have also spoken on the subject of whether the classification of developing and developed world is helpful to the debate. Now, this is obviously quite a difficult question, maybe controversial, but I think one key thing that actually struck me was we say the developing world will overtake the developed world in terms of emissions in 2015. What struck me was, why only in 2015? The amount of population, the people that live in what we will call the G77 countries, there are much more in the developing world than in the developed. So in terms of per person how much carbon emissions we produce, it's much less than developed world. So in fact, the fact that the carbon emissions of the developing world will only exceed that of the developed world in 2015 shows that we cannot divorce the climate change debate from the development debate, because we are not addressing the key problems of development around the world. And this poses problems as well to find solutions for climate change. To conclude, I would just like to say that islands are, in my opinion, barometers for the sustainability of this planet. If we can preserve, protect, and save the islands, we are the smallest populations, we are the smallest communities. If we can put in place the development mechanism which allows islands to be sustainable, you will have managed in the lowest unit, therefore you can manage it at a planetary level. And this is the problem. We have not created development conditions which are conducive for the smallest member, for the weakest members, for the most vulnerable members, the ones that don't have a voice, and therefore we cannot speak of sustainable development at a planetary level at this stage. And I am nonetheless, despite the fears, the pessimism, I do remain somewhat optimistic, because I do believe that the world needs us islands as much as we need the world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Adam. And we go now to our distinguished representing China today. I remind you that he's Vice Minister of the International Department from the Chinese Communist Party, Mr. HongJun Yu. I think I'm not mistaken if I say that there's huge expectation concerning China, who has become now one of the major contributors to the greenhouse gases in the world, and also one of the major economies of this planet, considering its fast-growing numbers. Mr. Yu, you have the floor.
非常高兴能有今天这样一个机会啊，来到美丽的丹吉尔和大家一起讨论这个气候问题。我是来自中国的代表，我的国家有960万平方公里，有将近14亿人口。 连续几十年呢，保持了9%以上的增长速度。所以呢，刚才主持人呢谈到大家在环境里呢对中国充满了期待，但我隐约也感到了一种压力。但不管怎么说，能和大家坐一起，特别能和塞舌尔啊这个朋友坐一起，从联合国的观点坐一起啊，说明啊环境问题啊是我们人类共同面临的一个严峻挑战啊，它关系到人类的 未来关系到我们的生活、生存、工作和发展。因时间关系啊，我先谈两个问题，先谈谈我们发展中国家啊如何共同应对啊气候谈判。第二个问题呢，谈谈发达国家如何应对气候谈判。如果大家有兴趣，我随后啊再讲讲我们中国是如何应对气候变化，采取了哪些措施来解决环境变化问题。 我先谈两个问题。气候变化应该说是重要的非传统安全问题，它直接影响到生态与环境啊。比如，气候变化威胁到了发展中国家粮食安全和生存空间。联合国的数据显示，全世界有10亿人挣扎在饥饿的边缘，如果不采取迅速行动，那么到2050年，气候变化 就可能威胁到数亿人的生活，威胁到数亿人的生存。那么联合国气候变化框架公约及其京都议定书已经成为我们各方公认的应对气候变化的主渠道。我们主张在这个问题上实行共同但有区别的原则，这个原则凝聚了国际社会的共识，是发展中国家参与气候谈判的基础。气候变化既是环境问题，更是发展问题，应对气候变化问题应该也只能在发展过程中推进。在应对气候变化的过程中，不能要求发展中国家承担超越发展阶段和我们实际能力的一种义务。国际社会应该重视发展中国家，特别是小岛屿国家，刚才塞舍尔朋友谈到的，重视最不发达国家、内陆国家，特别是非洲国家的困难处境，要尊重发展中国家的诉求，把应对气候变化和促进发展中国家的发展结合起来。如果不按照共同但有区别这样的原则来解决气候问题，那就意味着最贫穷国家的经济发展的终结，那这样显然是不合理的。全球现在还有24亿人呢，以煤炭、木炭、秸秆为主要燃料，还有16亿人呢还没有用上电。应对气候变化，必须在可持续发展的框架下统筹安排，绝不能以延续发展中国家的贫困、落后为代价。工业革命到现在200多年，这个发达国家排放的二氧化碳，大家都知道，占全球排放总量的80%。发达国家已经过上了富裕的生活，但现在仍然维持着远高于发展中国家的人均排放，这是一个不争的事实，而大多属于消费型的排放。那么相比之下，发展中国家，就是我们第三世界国家，我们的排放主要是生存排放和国际转移排放，要求发展中国家在几十年才开始工业化，是吧？还有大量人口处于绝对贫困状态的这些发展中国家承担超出自己应尽的义务和能力范围的减排目标，这不现实也没有道理。这是关于这个发展中国家，其中也包括中国，应对气候谈判的一个基本立场，就是共同但有区别的原则。这是我讲的第一点。第二点呢，就是发达国家如何来应对气候变化。我认为啊，支持发展中国家应对气候变化，那实际上也是在帮助发达国家自己。国际社会要做出切实有效的制度安排，促使发达国家兑现承诺。发展中国家就联合国的气候变化框架公约和京都议定书双轨谈判中有关重大问题形成了一致看法，要求发达国家提高这个减排的力度，履行强制性的减排义务，并且从技术上与资金等方面呢帮助发展中的国家，帮助第三世界国家，特别是要帮助这些小岛屿国家，帮助最不发达的国家、内陆国家、非洲国家，帮助这些国家加强应对气候变化的能力建设。有个统计数字表明说，发达国家对于发展中国家应对气候变化的资金援助每年最低应该达到1450亿欧元。现在发达国家呢只承诺在2010年到2012年呢提供300亿美元的额外资金，就刚才联合国官员呢谈到的区区300亿美元和实际所需要的1450亿欧元差别实在是太大这无异于杯水车薪。当然发展中国家包括中国也要根据自己的国情，在发达国家的支持下尽可能减缓的温室气体排放，适应气候变化，解决气候变化造成的压力，有效地应对这个挑战。发达国家应对气候变化既要着眼于长远，更要立足于当前。支持发展中国家应对气候变化，既是发达国家的一个责任，其实也符合发达国家自己的利益，符合他们的需要。京都议定书 明确规定发达国家到2012年第一期承诺的减排指标啊，但是现在执行情况应该说呢并不理想，不少发达国家的排放啊不但没有减少，反而有所增加。发达国家往往回避谈论的自身减排目标等这些实质性的问题，是吧？却在发展中国家的分类、减排援助资金规模、减排援助资金监督机制，以及联合国气候变化框架公约谈判机制等诸多问题上啊，斤斤计较，啊，舍本求末，是吧？啊，要求发展中国家承诺更多的减排义务，所以现在这个气候谈判呢变得困难重重。这是我对当前呢应对气候谈判、应对气候变化挑战呢所阐明的两个基本观点。刚才这个朋友们都谈到，从72年到现在将近40年过去了，这个我们在应对气候挑战方面呢动作呢应该说还不是十分有力，措施啊还不是十分到位，结果呀还不尽如人意，哥哥哈本会议啊甚至是失败了。但我想说啊，中国有句话叫失败乃成功之母，正是哥本哈根会议使我们大家都认识到环境问题、应对环境挑战和气候问题的谈判是多么艰难、多么复杂啊！解决这个任务是长期的，需要大家、需要国际社会共同的做出啊坚持不懈的努力啊！由于时间关系，我只谈这一点。如果大家想了解中国做了哪些，一会儿时间允许哈，我再稍稍谈一点，啊，谢谢大家。
We are of course pretty much interested in the position of China. I don't want to focus only on China, but if you allow me, we have approximately another 15 minutes to have a free discussion now between the panelists. I'd like to ask Mr. Yu a question, because earlier I said that in 2015 the total emissions, greenhouse emissions of the developing countries will exceed the emissions of the developed countries. But again, we have to ask this question, where do we put China? We know that China, considering its size and its population, is for certain aspects pretty much developed countries, but also is facing problems relating of developing countries. It's difficult to consider China anymore like an emergent country. It has emerged yet, but do we have to create a new category for China, or how do China consider itself? You were talking of developing countries, developed countries. Where do we have to put China today?
如果分类讲，中国人显然还属于发展中国家，当然也属于新兴国家。说中国是发展中国家，是因为我们呢，这个经济总量虽然排了世界第二位，但是我们人均的 GDP 呀，只有4000美元左右，这个整体的发展水平在世界上排位呀，这不是我们排的，是国际权威机构的，还排在了100位之后。那所以从这一点上讲，我们是一个纯纯粹粹的这个发展中国家，但是我们又是一个新兴国家，这是因为最近30年呢，中国这个经济增速很快，我刚才讲了，一直保持着9%以上的增长速度。中国是世界这个外汇储备大国，又是世界贸易大国，所以呢，我们毫无疑问属于增长发展比较快的新兴经济国家之列。如果分类，我想，按这两个标准来分类，都是比较合适的。谢谢。
Thank you for this answer. We've heard the point of the voice of these island countries that said they were very often voiceless in these huge conferences. And there's been question about the role of the United Nations. I'd like Mr. Kante maybe to answer. It's been said by, I think, the Prime Minister of Dominica that maybe the United Nations failed to implement what was decided in these summits. Would you like to answer this, please?
Prime Minister, may I answer you into French? No, I'm joking. Listen, I said in my preliminary statement that we are the mirror of countries, member states. And the failure of the UN is nothing else but the failure of countries. Furthermore, I told you with regard to the United Nations Environment Program that it was born in 1972. And in that date, if you had talked to them, to those countries who took responsibility to create because it was needed at that moment, the problems, the global environmental problems we face today have absolutely nothing to do with the problem, the global environmental problems of 1972. And still you want that same organization born in 1972 to deal with the global environmental problems, challenges of the 21st century. It's like day and night. If member states are not courageous enough and face the reality that today we have to change, to transform that UNEP into something you need as member states to help you to transition towards green economy, to transition towards blue economy, to transition to new energy demand. Listen, last year, from Copenhagen till now, $400 billion have been given to countries in subsidize fossil fuel thing. Imagine if those $400 billion were invested in green economy, in new energy, like wind, solar, and so on. Well, that will cut a lot the emissions. But who are we as UNEP, as UN, to dictate to member states what they have to do? We are struggling to transform UNEP into a World Environment Organization, which can be able to really help member states, especially developing countries, to deal with their challenges, global environmental challenges. And still, discussions are simply semantic. Dots, commas, double columns, and so on. This is the reality. So we are willing, we are shouting, we are screaming to come and help you. We are asking, give us the means, transform us, transform UNEP into something new, which is able to deal with the challenges of the 21st century. And then I assure you that things will be definitely different. Thank you.
Thank you. We see that the problem is the problem of global governance and the lack of global governance. In other words, we cannot think anymore in terms of emerging countries, developed countries, developing countries, trying to oppose them one another. We've seen the problem we have with China, classifying China. We've been thinking in these terms for that long, for 40 years maybe. What is the solution, according to you? And maybe again, Mr. Kante, or anyone wants to answer. What is the solution? What do we have to do to make that the Rio summit is not going to be another failure?
I mean, my view is this, that developing countries, which make up the majority of the UN membership, must take certain actions to draw the rest of the world's attention to the issues. And I'm going to be bold to say that all of us next year should boycott the UN General Assembly. And to say, look, we will not come to do any voting at the UN because a fundamental issue confronting the world is not being addressed by ourselves. And unless we take drastic action, revolutionary action, we'll have the same thing, the cycle of discussion going over and over again. So there has to be certain actions taken. And we have to, on a diplomatic front also, say to our partners, who from time to time will need us on certain matters, look, you have taken a particular divergent view on the issues to be addressed in respect to climate change. And it is a matter which is affecting our very survival. And I believe that we have to take drastic action, and it has to be political action. I am not holding UNEP responsible, but in the same token, UNEP and the UN have a responsibility to advise. It is up to us if we want to take the advice given. But they must put a position paper in Durban or Rio to say, from a professional standpoint, this is how we would like to see things go ahead. These are decisions we'd like to take and the time frame within which to implement them. But to have that implementation capacity, we need to reform the UN, the UNEP, and so forth. There has been a lot of talk about UN reform,